Hello, Lake Point Bible Church. I'm Pastor Dean Johnson, and it's Sunday, May 10th, 2020. And I'm here in the nursery of our church building because today is Mother's Day. And I am so sorry that we can't do our annual Red Rose ceremony, but we do have some video of some of our kids honoring their moms, and let's watch them now.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. I wanted to tell you one of the reasons why I love you. I love how caring and kind you are to all of us, whether it's your students or whether if it's all of us. Thank you, and happy Mother's Day.
Hi, Mom. I hope you have a good day at Mother's Day. So, yeah, I hope you have a good time today. Bye.
Hi, Mom. I love you. I love sleeping in your bed. Bye.
Jeremy,
Daniel,
Eliana,
Joanna.
Happy Mother's Day!
One of the things I like about my mom is that she helps me a lot with my schoolwork and stuff, especially when I'm writing papers. Happy Mother's Day!
I like that my mom is really adventurous and she goes on lots of canoe trips and hikes with me. I love you, Mom.
I like that my mom is very artistic and she can help me learn how to do lots of art projects. I love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
I'm most thankful for my mom, Elaine Makovic, because of her unconditional love for me. Sometimes she might not like me, some of the stuff I do, but deep down, she'll always love me, and she's always been there for me, and she cares for so many people, and just the strength that she has is really encouraging.
I'm thankful for that mama's spent time every weekend with me.
Anna, what do you appreciate about?
I'm thankful for that she loves me.
Mark?
I'm thankful that she makes food for our family.
My mom is Miss Julie Walters. Not enough words can describe her compassionate heart, but she's always caring and loving and empathetic towards others.
I love you, Mom.
Love you.
I'm August Justice. I love my mom because she's very caring.
I'm Monica. I love my mom because she's compassionate and puts everyone above herself.
I'm Gabe and I love my mom because she's cool.
I'm Grace. Mom works really hard.
A lot of times Mom prays on the way with me.
What about you?
I'm thankful that Mom, she feeds us really well.
I'm thankful that my mom, Mom will play with me a lot.
Else.
And she is really beautiful and I love her.
Same.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you and I'm so appreciative of everything that you do. The list is just endless and I hope that you feel appreciated today and as you always should, but I love you so much.
Something I appreciate about my mom is that she's always there when we need her.
Something I really appreciate about my mom is that she works really hard to buy food and clothes for me.
Something I appreciate about my mom is she motivates me to be my best all the time.
Happy Mother's Day, Mommy. We love you.
Thank you, Mom. Thank you for helping us with our homework. And we love you so much.
Thank you for helping our homework, and I love you so much.
And thank you for caring about us.
Happy Mother's Day, Mama.
I appreciate you because you are loving and you care for people.
We love you.
We love you.
Bye.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for providing clean, sometimes home for us. And thanks for being there for me. Happy Mother's Day.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for cooking for me for a long time and teaching me how to cook some stuff, even though I still haven't figured out how to measure food, but that'll be fun.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for teaching me so much and teaching me up in homeschool and preparing me for high school.
Hi, Mom. Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for being a really great mom.
I appreciate my mom because she cooks for us.
I appreciate my mom's consistency.
Good morning, Lake Pointe family. Before we get started this morning, we just wanted to say that we miss you, that we miss seeing you, and that we're looking forward to when we can all be together again. We're grateful that we're able to talk to you on Zoom or through other messages, and thank you for sending us messages. We appreciate just being able to worship together. For our first song this morning, we're going to be doing There Is a Redeemer. As I was thinking about this song, I was thinking about the last words of Jesus to his disciples when he said to them to go into all the world and to preach the gospel and to tell all nations about him. And I was thinking about how the message that he wanted them to bring is the message of this song, that there is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, the precious Lamb of God, the Messiah, the Holy One. Let's sing together. Asked him to teach them how to pray. He told them that when they pray to God the Father, they should say, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven." In teaching them this, he was telling them that they should be in alignment with God and his purposes in the world, that they should be seeking to be on God's side, not for God to be on their side. Our second song today expresses a similar idea. It's called, "Lord, You Have My Heart." It says, "Lord, You have my heart, and I will search for Yours. Jesus, take my life and lead me on. Lord, You have my heart, and I will search for Yours. Let me be to You a sacrifice." Let's sing together.
Lord, You have my heart, and I will serve.
Let's pray together. Lord, we pray that you really would have our hearts, that we would be aligned with your will, that your will would be done and your kingdom would come in our lives and in this world, that we would seek to be on your side. We thank you, Lord, for all you've done for us. We pray that we would be doing your work every day in our conversations and in our actions. In Jesus' name, amen. Our last song today is called Let It Be Said of Us. It describes the way that we should live. It's based on a verse in 2 Timothy chapter 4, where Paul is writing about his life and he is saying, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. This is a description of the Christian life, of how we are to live for God, giving ourselves to him. Let's sing together.
Church. This is Jerry and Beth. We have been attending Lake Point since last fall. We have two young adult sons and two dogs, and we are attending the Discovery class.
Yes, the Discovery class has given us the opportunity to meet many nice people and learn a lot more about Lake Point. And we just want to take this opportunity to say thank you to everyone for being so warm and welcoming, and for answering all of our questions. During this COVID crisis, Jerry and I have been asking God to show us ways that we can help others in need. And maybe you had the same question. God was faithful, and he reminded us of a time when we were in our own personal crisis, maybe not as bad as this COVID crisis, but we were in our own crisis of unemployment. We had a couple of times of unemployment during our marriage. God gave us people in our lives, our family and friends, who would pray with us, who would give us a phone call just to talk, who would even sometimes leave groceries on our steps. This was such a blessing to us.
Yes, we felt God was watching over us and caring for us through his church.
And so he showed us there may be many big or small ways that we can be a blessing to people and that people really appreciate it.
Today's scripture reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. Many people think that when God comforts us, our troubles should go away. That's not always the case. Every trial you endure will help you comfort other people who are suffering similar troubles. We look forward to the day when we could worship together again in person at Lake Point. Stay safe and take care.
Yes, be well.
Hi, Lake Point family. If any of you don't know me, my name's Erica Schmeck, and I'm going to share a little bit of my story with you. Many of you will laugh when you hear this, but I always had a timeline for my life. I had planned out all my major milestones, when I'd meet my future husband, when we'd get married, when we'd have children, and so on. Don't worry, I understood not everything was according to my timeline, so I factored in 6 months of flexibility here and there. I got it, God, you're the boss, all in your time. But nothing, and I mean nothing, went according to my plan, let alone any timeline. My train derailed pretty early on with no hope of getting back on track. And it was so painful, and I carried so much guilt and so much shame for the way things were not going and what I had not accomplished. When I was younger, I used to pray one thing over and over, Lord, let me be your instrument. Here I am, Lord, send me. My inspiration came from a song we used to sing in church, based on the story of Isaiah and God's heart for the Israelite people. Here's a little bit of that song called Here I Am, Lord.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry. Oh, who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
Retrospect, I had no idea what I was praying for. I could not imagine the challenges I would face. But all the while, God was calling out to me, and God was working in my life in ways that would not become clear until much later, and in ways that are still unclear to me. Through what seemed like a series of unrelated, emotionally painful events, I ended up pursuing a ministry degree. I discovered a passion, and I encountered Jesus. It eventually led me to Lake Point, where I met all of you and learned what a loving church family is. I never ever would have thought that I would pursue religious studies in any form, and I never would have imagined that I actually really enjoy preaching. My life is not at all what I had planned, but it's so much greater. There's still a lot of uncertainty, but I know in my spirit and in my heart that I am called by our magnificent God to be a part of God's mission in the world in some way. Little Erica may not have known what she was asking, but I'm glad she asked. I continue to pray that prayer today. Make me your instrument. Here I am, Lord. Send me. I don't know how God will use me, and I still struggle with a lot of unknowns, especially now, but I've learned to trust the process. I try not to be anxious when things seem out of my control, because I know God is in control. And things turn out better when God does the planning. The pain and hardship that I've endured are a part of my narrative that ultimately tells of the glory of God and will work to serve others in some way. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose." Our God hears our prayers and responds, just sometimes in unexpected ways.
All right, Lake Pointe, are you ready to study God's word? Do you have your Bible with you? Will you open to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5? We have been studying this letter in the New Testament, known as 1 Thessalonians, and we call our study a church that is doing well. We're getting near the end of the letter to a section that I call living in the community of believers. Paul reminds us that the church really is a community of believers. Church is not a service that you go to once a week, like a concert or a lecture you attend. We've got to stop thinking about church that way. Church is not a religious ritual that we must fulfill, like putting in our time once a week for God. We've got to stop thinking about church that way. Church is not an obligation you must fulfill. We've got to stop thinking about church that way. Church is not a building you go to. We've got to stop thinking about church that way. Listen, church is a community of people. Crystal and I have been watching a TV show called Waco. It's about the Branch Davidians down in Texas and their leader, David Koresh. And he's got all these rules for them to follow to be part of the commune. Let me ask you, could you be part of a commune like that? When Crystal and I were first married, there were two other young, newly married couples that we were friends with. There was Jim and Tanya, and there was Brent and Karen. And both were Christian couples, and they became convinced that it was very important to live in community as Christians. And so they bought a house together, and they moved in together. And I think their hope was that eventually there'd be even more people that would be involved in that. But I'm sad to say it didn't last very long. And I don't know the details. I don't know why. But pretty soon, Brent and Karen moved out. Well, let me ask you, could you live in community like that? Because I have to tell you, while God doesn't ask you to move into a commune, he has asked you to be part of a community of believers, and that is the church. Now, when you think about it, that's an awful lot to ask. That when you become convinced of the truth of the gospel and you put your faith in Christ, automatically you become part of this group with which you had no previous relationship. You come into contact with these people with whom you had no previous affinity. And some of them you'll like and you'll get along with, but it's probably fair to say that some of them you won't. What are you going to do with that? Well, Paul understands that this is an issue, and that is what 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 is about. So Tricia Vess is going to read for us now 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 12 through 15.
1 Thessalonians 5, 12 through 15. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Hold them in the highest regard and love because of their work. live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else.
Thanks, Tricia. So here the Apostle Paul gives 8 short, crisp directives on how we are to get along with each other in the community of believers. The first one is respect your church leaders. We studied that last Sunday. The second statement is live in peace with each other. Third, warn those who are idle and disruptive. The fourth statement is encourage the disheartened. Fifth, help the weak. There's weak inside the church? Yes, there is, and that's okay. Sixth, be patient with everyone. Seventh, make sure nobody pays back wrong for wrong. And the last one, do what is good for those inside the church and those outside the church. If you're like me, you're probably asking yourself, why does the Apostle Paul even need to say these things? Shouldn't they be natural? Shouldn't they come automatically? Especially for a person who has repented and accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior? Well, apparently not, or Paul wouldn't have said them. Even after you trust Christ and your sins are forgiven, you still struggle with issues from before, like pride and anger and self-righteousness. And it's part of the process of what we call sanctification, where God uses his word, like 1 Thessalonians 5, to convict us and to change us into the people he desires us to be. And only when we yield ourselves to his word will we be this community of believers the way he intends for us to be. Let's think about this one for a minute. Live in peace with each other. Again, shouldn't that just be automatic? I mean, we're all Christians here. Wouldn't you think we would just get along? Well, you know from experience that that's not the case. And like me, I imagine you're disappointed in that fact. But this is so important because this is how most people are drawn to the gospel. It says they will know we are Christians by our love. If we don't have this, we don't have anything. Mark 9:50 says, salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Have salt among yourselves and be at peace with each other. So our salt, our thing that makes us different, our thing that makes us stick out in the world, is that we love each other. We don't argue. We don't hate each other. And if we lose that, it's going to be very hard to get back. That very thing is the testimony of the church that draws people in, our love for each other. If we lose that testimony, it's going to be almost impossible to get back. Live at peace with each other. Well, how do we do this, practically speaking? For me, it starts with yielding myself to God's word and to his spirit, rather than to my desire to be right, or my desire to be heard, or my need for revenge. For many of us, I think it would just mean keeping our mouth shut sometimes, you know, holding my tongue for the glory of God. I want to value the testimony of Christ's church more than I value my right to be right. If I hurt someone, I want to be quick to swallow my pride and to apologize. And I want to pray for a person who has hurt me rather than gossip about them or strike back. And I'll trust the Lord with all that stuff. It's in his hands. Leave that to him. He'll take care of it. So live in peace with each other. Is that something I can do? Well, no, not on my own. But in the power of the Holy Spirit who dwells in me and who uses his word to remind me and to convict me and to draw me closer to the God who saved me, yeah, that's something I think I can work on. Right now, Keith Klein is going to share with us about the next of Paul's statements in 1 Thessalonians 5.
Hello, Lake Point. I'm Keith Klein, and I'm speaking to you today from 1 Corinthians chapter 5, from the first part of verse 14, where Paul writes, "Brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive." Taken at first glance, this seems like a rather straightforward command, but the context is a little striking. Paul had just finished telling them to live in peace with one another, and now he's telling them to warn each other. Paul, what are you thinking? We might think that living in peace means avoiding conflict, but that's simply not the case. And Paul understands this, which is why he could tell the Thessalonians to warn one another right after he told them to live in peace. These commands are not contradictory. They are complementary. Let's take a little activity break now. Here's seven words that deal with different ways that we can influence one another. And I will ask you to pause the video in just a minute. And during that pause, what I would like you to do is sort out these words in order from easiest to hardest. And easiest means these are easiest for me to receive. And hardest means it's harder for me, more difficult for me to receive words spoken to me like this. Now, sometimes you might feel like two words are the same, and that's okay. Just put them next to each other in your list. And if you don't know what a word means, just pull it out. That doesn't matter. If you're with a group of people, each of you do your own list and then discuss it with each other. How did you sort the words? What was different and why? Whatever you do, don't get in a fight with each other about this. Okay, the goal is to help us to understand how we perceive these different words. Okay, you can pause the video now. We did this activity earlier this week as a family, and it led to some great discussions. You know, even our puppy Poe participated in his own version. When we did the activity, I asked you to think about how you would receive words like that. But it's important to think about how we feel about delivering words like that as well. As a family, we found that for most of us, our order of words was mostly the same, whether delivering them or receiving them. How about you? Would it be the same for you, or what would be different? And why do you think there would be a difference? And one of the things, you know, we talked about was why some of the words were difficult for us. Why do you think some things are more difficult for you than others? I was thinking about it, and I realized, you know, some of the higher levels of confrontation are hard for me, and part of me wonders if selfishly I just don't want to be on the receiving end of it either. I want to say that I included the word berate in that list to give you a strong negative pull. To berate means to cut someone down with no redemptive purpose whatsoever. We should never want to be berated, nor should we ever berate anybody else. The other words in the list all have their appropriate place in biblical peacemaking. One of the things that was interesting as our family did this activity was the word warn was placed, had the greatest variation in where it was placed, whether it was an easy word or a much harder word. And in general, that seemed to correlate with our ages, where the younger family members found warning to be an easier word, a lighter word, and maybe that's because their lives are full of lots of warnings. Look both ways before you cross the street. Don't touch the stove, it's hot. Whereas those of us who are older felt like warning carried much more weight of a personal change and much more significance to it. That level of personal change and that weight is how Paul is using the word warn in today's passage where he's urging the Thessalonians to warn those who are idle and disruptive.
Wait a second. I thought we were supposed to love and accept one another.
Yeah, aren't we supposed to forgive others?
Didn't Jesus tell us to turn the other cheek?
Yes, yes, and yes. We are supposed to love, forgive, and turn the other cheek. Those biblical commands are part of what makes having loving confrontational conversations difficult for many of us. We get a little confused. Aren't I supposed to forgive people? Then how can I confront and call them out for this behavior? Let me try to bring a little bit of clarity to that. When I think about somebody sinning against me, harming me, I forgive them. I may need to talk with them to help them understand how they harmed me so that they don't do it again. And if they continue harming me, I may need to take other actions so that they can't do that anymore. But when I think about somebody's sin harming themselves or harming other people, then I need to confront them in love because I care about them. I care about the harm they're doing to themselves. In today's passage, there appear to be a group of people who were hangers-on, moochers of the Thessalonian church. They were benefiting from the hospitality and generosity of the church without contributing anything to the community. And in fact, they were in turn being disruptive. The church can forgive them for that. But at the same time, their lazy and unruly habits would bring them harm in the end. And there may be outsiders looking to the church who are discouraged from pursuing the gospel because of their behavior. There might even be other believers in the church who are led astray by these behaviors. So the loving thing to do is to confront them. I once heard a talk by the Christian psychologist and author Dr. Henry Cloud that he called the four corners of the relational universe. This is not directly from the Bible, but it is well aligned with biblical principles. It's very logical, and I've personally found it to be a very helpful paradigm. So in the four corners of the relational universe, we start out with corner number one, where we have no relationship. We're completely alone and isolated. We were not made for this. We were made for relationship. And it's a nice place to visit from time to time, but we can't live here. Most of us would go insane if we were left in solitary confinement long enough. Part of the mental and emotional stress we feel in these days during our COVID quarantine is because we were made for a relationship. Corner number two is a bad relationship. This is because sin has taken over our world, and relationships are full of coercion and abuse and deceit and infidelity. There's all forms of manipulation. We're in bad relationships. We feel bad. We are hurt. We are harmed. Sadly, corner number two relationships can happen in Christian families and even in churches. The third corner are fake relationships. This is where escapism, where addictions thrive and live. We're not real with anybody. We just pretend. We have imaginary relationships. We are superficial. We wear our masks. Maybe we feel safe, but we certainly don't feel connected. And obviously the fourth and final corner is where we find good relationships. This is where love and acceptance flourish. This is where we know and are fully known, and we're still loved and accepted even when we're fully known. This is where we mourn together and we rejoice together. This is where we speak hard words, confrontational words, but with love and humility, and we spur one another on, and we help aid God in his work of transformation and sanctification in our lives. This is a good place to be. We are filled with joy and peace and safety when we are in this place. you know, one of the sad things in this world is that for many, they just move from corner one to two to three and back again and all sorts of patterns, trying to escape the pain of one corner and only replacing it with the pain of the other corner. But they don't know anything else. It's all they've ever known. It's all they ever think there can be. The reality of the gospel is that Jesus, in his death, in his resurrection, he has opened up the path for us to live in a corner number four community where we have good relationships. He's restored our relationship with our Heavenly Father, and he's made it possible for us to have restored relationships with one another. You know, I minimize the gospel if I think it's just about me getting into heaven. This corner number four community, it's a central part of the gospel blessing. One of my favorite descriptions of the church comes from Titus 2:14. It says, Jesus gave himself up to redeem us from all wickedness, to purify for himself a people who are eager to do what is good. Jesus wants a people, his own people, who are eager to do what is good. Jesus wants a corner number four community. I want a corner number four community. And I would love it if you would join me there. You know, Paul understood that giving and receiving confrontational words, warnings, with love and humility was an essential part to living in a corner four community. That's why he could go right from live in peace to warn the others. It's all part of this vision for those believers and those soon-to-be, yet-to-be believers in Thessalonica. Sadly, by the time we get to 2 Thessalonians, Paul's five-word command to warn those who are idle and disruptive has grown into an entire paragraph. The situation has intensified. We don't know why. We don't know if the warning was never given, or if it was given, but it was not received. All we know is the problem persists and needs to be dealt with in a deeper manner. But that story is not for today. That's for another day. Hopefully you'll journey with us in corner number four for a few more weeks to hear that part of the story. Thank you so much for letting me share with you today.
So let's pray that we would yield ourselves to God's Spirit when it comes to living at peace with each other and doing whatever is necessary to do that for the unity of the church, and also having the will to lovingly challenge each other so that Christ is honored in his church. So pray with me. Father, we yield ourselves now to you, to your Spirit. We ask that you would use your word to convict us when our hearts turn these ways that are not helpful. Help us to be people of peace. Help us to be people who love our brothers and sisters enough to challenge each other in love so that we honor and glorify you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Bye-bye.